feeling fine. Looking good and feeling fine. Looking good and feeling fine.
Slay, slay.
Looking good and feeling fine. Looking good and feeling fine. Looking good and feeling fine.
Fashion.
Step into the room like it's a catwalk.
Fashion.
Singing to the tune just to keep them talking.
Fashion.
Walk into the light, display your diamonds and pearls in light.
Fashion.
Married to the night.
Hi guys, we are down my runway, walking live right now in Scottsdale, making the crowd go wild. Do you like it? Maybe it's Maybelline. There's a total of how many questions? Five?
Five. But I'll probably, as
elaborate.
You talk, you can talk as much as you want, and then I'll add some in based off of your response.
Okay.
Just making sure it looks good. So far, it looks good. Okay. Perfect. So, how did your childhood shape who you are and what you became?
I think my childhood's very interesting because I grew up in Winslow, Arizona. It's a small town, and I think coming from a small town, you normally don't get a diversity. Having a crown and becoming homecoming king and not being the most masculine and actually being the most feminine on the football team, it was unique. And I think it shaped me and told me, myself, that I can do anything. You don't have to hinder yourself in what people tell you you could be. But you can go outside the odds and overcome what anyone says you can't or can do. When I first graduated high school, I went to this modeling convention. Went with the Agency Arizona, and I started with the Agency Arizona, and I was with them for 7 years, and then went to Ford. And then after Ford, I went to Dijon Me, which is in New York. New York was one of my most gratified, liberating experiences as far as being very spiritual, getting into my spiritual sense. I realized the false facade of entertainment and modeling and fashion, but also meeting the people in New York who naturally were themselves. It showed me true, what it is means to be true, and also judgment, to look past judgment of what it is that you see, because you never know someone's story until you really sit down and talk to them. Also, I think New York being the melting pot of the world, again, I think that's one of the most cultural place that you could possibly meet everybody in one unique place, whether it be fashion or Times Square at McDonald's. So when I started modeling, I would always have people come up to me and be like, you should model. And it kind of would make me feel shy. And I was like, oh, okay. And then when I started modeling, I got the same comments from just random people. And you don't say, I'm a model. It just makes you insecure, I guess you could say. But reaching the truth about it is you have to love yourself. You know, and if you love yourself, it doesn't matter what anyone says. There's not a booker or there's not a casting agent who can cast you down and just know you weren't right for the project, but you're still beautiful inside and out if you know who you are. It was a huge humbling experience because I think when you start out in a secondary market in modeling, you want to go for, you know, the Vogue, you want to go for the W, because here, I mean, doing things locally is very fun too, but you want to be, if you're a hardcore fashion kid like myself, and things that are international. So moving to New York, that's what it gave me a little bit, like a taste of going to like Fashion Week and stuff like that. I began to be a little arrogant in a sense of, why am I back here for like Phoenix Fashion Week? I already modeled here. You know what I mean? It's like, I'm going backwards. But in a sense, the humbling part is appreciating a designer and an artist. No, they may not be a Tom Ford. No, they may not be a Dries Van Noten, but I think at the end of the day, everyone has to start somewhere. So why not appreciate the artist for who they are, and more so understand the product of the artist of which he's producing? That's what fashion is about, is a story, more so than the clothing. It's interesting because I feel liberated in the sense of embracing femininity with masculinity, because that's my personality. And it always has been since I was a child. But I think, you know, having a grandmother, and I think that's every designer, or that sort of story, my grandma, my mommy. But my grandma's a bingo lady, and she, you know, wears a lot of sequins, and she passed away. And I think me, I don't have that, you know, going to the next family event, someone wearing sparkles and having a plastic pool in their car. I want to fill the gap of my grandmother. But in addition to being regal and romantic and also a little playful, Royal Black Sheep is more so, again, about embracing your own individuality, but feeling as a regal something. I would never tell my dad this, but I think when I was like 5, I felt like I wasn't a part of my family, and like a limo was gonna come pick me up. And I think natural instincts based upon my faith, my love, my heart, I think naturally it makes anyone royalty. And I think love is the royal of the universe. And I think anyone can do it if they know how to give someone water or something to eat. When you adore fashion, not worship fashion, because fashion without a soul is dead. Naturally, 30 seconds is all you really need to choose an outfit. You know, it's not so much praising the outfit, but more so the soul in the outfit. And I think when people can appreciate that more than the clothing outside, that's all it is, really, fabrics. You know, it's something that can fade away, get moldy, get old, get torn. But I think when you put it on the soul that it's right for, that expresses, what is your favorite color that you see being nude? You know, purple. So put purple on. Wow, that really is you. You know, it's just little things that help match the person. And I think who I am today, it's not if it matches me. Dignity goes a long way. And I think that's exactly what it is. This is my dollar shirt too. I got it yesterday at Second Chances. It's for $1. I'm very excited about it. I just feel it's just dignity, you know? And I think when you have a dignified soul, that's what my grandmother also told me. Just be dignified. I think the struggle is, I think before people begin to know who I am, they see me as arrogant, they see me as abominable, they see me as mysterious. And I think anything that you do not understand, you begin to fear. And I think, not even just as Americans, but as fleshly people and humanity, we've lost track of understanding people. And I think sitting down like this is a way to find out really who someone is versus, again, a stereotype, a notion, or what someone else told you, but based on gossip. It's really good to get your own opinion, and your own opinion would be your own heart commenting, not even judging, but commenting whether or not you see that person being beneficial in your life. And if they're not beneficial for your life, that's okay, but they could be beneficial for somebody else's life. So that's what I see. So I've always been my authentic self, always. I think there was a period coming into Arizona, and people always laughed at me when I was on public transportation. I would wear snakeskin cowboy boots and like True Religion jeans, and they'd be like, oh, this black dude's trying to be like Kanye West. They would always laugh at me, and I was like, what do I have to do in the city? Because I'm from a small town. I thought it was kind of normal. And I began to blend in with the urban crowd by wearing Timberlands and tall tees. And it was weird because going to those urban clubs in the nightlife, and my twin brother, it's not that I didn't fit in. It wasn't organically who I was. I was trying to be someone else. And I think when you do all of that, you begin to put more pressure on yourself versus it just being. Even if I was mimicking someone, it's still myself, because there's something I admired about you enough to even mimic. And I think that's what I pick up on. For me, judgment, even if it's geared towards fashion, why judge someone according to how they want to express themselves? Even if it is a t-shirt and shorts, they show themselves as easygoing. Versus, D-squared, you know, with the Speedo on the yacht. You know, I just don't think either one should judge you. either or. However, I think upon that judgment, it goes with insecurity. So I think, what perception is that person who's judging? What are they looking to project? And a lot of times it's more so, you know, they're looking to destroy something. And if they're looking to destroy your heart, you can look past that easily and say, they need help. God loves them too. Or love is available if they want it. You know, it's whatever is there for them. I know, happiness, the root of happiness is joy. And when you have joy, it doesn't waver. It's the root of happiness. Happiness, you can go sad and then get happy, and then sad and get happy. And I think the root of joy is the spirit of, ultimately, of who I desire to be with, in the end, and that's the Holy Spirit. For me, only when you do the ecstasy of life, that you enjoy life and the best music, the best food, the best clothing for you, what makes you comfortable. You know, a sequence would make a lot of people comfortable, but, you know, if it's silks or t-shirts, do what's the best for you. And I think ultimately that's how you'll find happiness.
Hello, my royal lambs. I'm just testing out my outfit. It's early in the morning, like 12-ish, going on 1-ish. And I wanted to see exactly what I should wear tomorrow when I go get my coffee javi. All right, let's test it out. I got these from, because it reminded me of a Gucci campaign, and I wore this kind of band over my head because I look like a chicken head. Not really, but I got it an inspiration from a Valentino ad, and I made this bag an inspiration from, I think it was Lavon. I'm not too sure, but anyways, who cares? It says Chanel right there. It's from a zipper of a Chanel bag. Anyways, let's see what we can do.
Do you guys like it? I don't know if I like it. I like it. Mommy, buy it for me. Mommy, buy it. I think it's adorable. What do you guys say? And this is a Ralph Lauren bag here.
We're gonna rock it out. We're gonna rock this out, and it's gonna show in like a kitten in outer space. Oh my gosh. Literally, it's going to shine, y'all. Tell me your thoughts. Bye.
Hi, my royal lambs. I hope that you guys are all doing really well today. I haven't done these in so long, but I only do it when God tells me to. Anywho, really quick, you guys. God has just given me, he gave me a huge revelation. I feel there's so many people. There are so many people, you know, that talk about being positive, you know, and I was like, God was showing me being positive is good, but I feel to do it, it's kind of like a workout. You know, when you say workout and you think of the workout, it's 90% a challenge to think about it than to actually work out. So when you say positive, do you know how many syllables is in positive?
It's
not that I didn't want to stay in New York. I went with problems, but letting go of the problems that carried me to New York in the first place. I have a daughter, Lauren Olivia Mattox, becoming a man, not only a man, provocatively a feminine man, where people say, oh, he doesn't really have, you know, he's a queen. Like, I have semen too. Even though she's not with me today, I do think you can put out fruit into the world in order for it to multiply to do also something else great. My house burned down here in Phoenix, and my best friend, Severa, was in Miami, but moving to New York, and I had met a friend, Bradley, and he's like, I'm going to New York, you should move with me, and I was like, ah, this is the right time. Like, you know, my whole closet and my home's burned, so I left drinking. I was really big in drinking, you know, partying like Lindsay Lohan. I had made a covenant with the creator of the universe that I would not drink if he would allow me to go to New York, and I didn't drink, but I also have a life history of escorting. And as I did that the second semester of my stay in New York, you know, I came back in regards to my daughter again, and also because my father was sick. And I think when you allow yourself to entities and open up to things while being in danger because of the entities around you, knowing who you are internally, New York was like Disneyland. And for me, the first experience in 1994, it was so heavenly. I wouldn't want to go back, because I would want that same ecstasy, that same feeling, and if it was lower than that, I would be depressed.
How do you combat the two opposing ideas of being a dad, but also feminine?
I love it. And I think that's a part of God creating humanity and each human individually and divinely in his image, making us beautifully, fearfully, wonderfully made. And it's because of my controversial, abominable, they say, past and also my present that makes me fight things for people to see the truth. And the truth is all about love. And when you understand God, you understand love. It overrides any judgment. And I think the judgment of being the dad, you never want to be a deadbeat dad, you know, a dad who doesn't want to take care of your daughter or your children. You don't want to negate your responsibility. But for me, it's something that is refining and defining, because I think that's what my lordship is, what people try to take away, but they can't. In Victorian, men were stacked heels, you know, and I think that's very feminine, but that's because they didn't have the height, and height is masculinity. So I think masculinity and femininity is really one's own vocabulary as beauty, what's beautiful. And to me, what's beautiful is speech. I don't know what color you are. I don't know how beautiful you are based on your shell, but let me hear you speak. And when I hear you speak, then that will reflect what is in your heart. And then I will reflect off my comment if I like the beauty that I see. And I think fashion, femininity, and masculinity, who cares? I think though masculinity is standing above the odds. And to me, that's what I have to do. The odds are against me, even today. But what stands against the odds, again, what's greater is love. It sounds so cheesy, but love is so much greater. Somebody yells at you and they go, I messed up. And then, and then it shows in themselves. And then as long as you can acknowledge your problem, you're no better than a human being. And we're all not perfect people.
That's not I had the strangest dream. I sailed away to China in a little rock boat to find ya. And you said you had to get your laundry clean.
Hey, my royal lambs. I hope that you guys are all having a fantastic day as I am. As you can see, we back in business! Technically, on this day, I'm homeless. And I'm here at the campy, though, enjoying the campfire and, you know, some music and everything. But, you know, I don't even have groceries in my apartment or anything like that. But, you know, I'm thinking, what is really so bad? What is so bad that we can't smile? And, you know, as I was crossing the street from the Biltmore to come over to the campy, I was like, okay, you know what? This lady had a grimace on her face. And I'm like, smile, what's so bad? You know, you have no money, smile. You lost your job, smile. You know, marriage isn't going right, smile. You know, again, what is so bad that you can't smile? What is so bad that you can't give love? What is so bad that you don't want peace? If you don't